this is really the month before the storm, as it were, to our second now workshop for the 2013-14 University of Texas Language Center workshop. My name is Tom Garza. I'm the director of the CLC. I'm also an associate professor in the Department of Slavic and Eurasian Studies. I teach Russian and all things related. And I am delighted to welcome you this morning to join us on this particularly, I think, topic of immediate interest to those who are doing work in the classroom. That is, we've chosen this year, by the way, through all of our TLC workshops to focus on the interface between technology and what we do in a more traditional sense of trying to create blended or hybrid style classrooms, which seems to be not simply a trend right now, but actually a movement in the right direction of a lot of what we're doing in our language classrooms, certainly here at the University of Texas. I'm delighted to have, I'll start off our day, our morning today, and as we go along, introduce three of my very distinguished, and I'm so delighted because they're not just my colleagues, they're also my good friends who will be following up the talks this morning and this afternoon. We also will feed you. Betsy, I always thank for doing all the hard work in organizing these events for us, also has provided herself cooked all night with her own hands, a lovely lunch. I know you're going to enjoy that as well. Let me dive in. So our theme today is this kind of blogs and chat, which we, using social media in the foreign language classroom, foreign language instruction. And today we're going to do everything from looking at applications of Facebook, Twitter, Tumblr, all our kind of usual suspects, and really trying to both give you a practical sense of how these are in place or about to be implemented in our own classrooms, and to try to get from you a dialogue about what you think of these particular techniques, and go from there. So let me, without further ado, get started. And there it is. So I'm going to start with a focus in particular of using in our intensive Russian program several different social media in particular. We use a lot of Facebook, we use a lot of Blackboard chat room, the blog side of Blackboard as well. But I wanted to focus today on tweeting. I want to talk to you, if I may, today about tweeting. And if you haven't thought about getting into Twitter and tweeting with your students and so forth, maybe after a few minutes together, I can kind of persuade you to think about this. I'll talk a little bit about how this theme of this morning's workshop came to be by taking us back several decades, just very quickly to kind of do the why is it, how did we get from there to here kind of talk. If you remember back then, you don't, some of us remember very clearly. In 1982, Time Magazine's Person of the Year was not, and this was, I think, in 82, what was going on. Brezhnev, after his long, long reign, finally dies. The HIV/AIDS virus is discovered and identified as what it is. Michael Jackson's Thriller album comes out. Yeah. I think of some of the best things that happened in world history that year. But Time chose the computer, the personal computer, as its Person of the Year. Now, what I love is that Time puts this up and makes an incredibly compelling case as to why this is the thing that most influenced the news in the year 1982. Fewer than 10 million users worldwide had access to or actually owned used personal computers. Today, the number probably like the national debt just grows incrementally as we move along with how many people all over use them. Very quickly after personal computers crept into our not just businesses, but our homes, instant messaging, the idea that you could, rather than call someone up, very quickly zap someone, text me, became the code word for give me a call. We didn't use our telephones nearly as much as we could use free and accessible instant messaging. And very quickly after that, as we approach into the 1990s, social media really began to take on a life of their own, starting first and foremost, or maybe not so much starting with, but we think of now as the father of all social media, Mark Zuckerberg's Harvard-bred creation, FaceMash, as it was originally called, or eventually into this incarnation, Facebook, which now, I dare to say, everyone sitting in this room probably has a Facebook account. If you don't, your friends are asking you, why don't you have a Facebook account? there you go. Why don't you have a Facebook? You should have a Facebook account. And indeed, I talk to my colleagues in Russia using Facebook and all the time now. It's become this kind of this lingua franca of our worldview. I've given talks on using Facebook in language, but indeed I wanted to focus on something slightly different today. In fact, in Russia, the two sites very similar to ВКонтакте and Одноклассники both are the sort of Russian varieties of Facebook that have the same prominence that Facebook has in this country. And soon after Facebook gained that kind of very quick, it's kind of infusion into not just our individual personal computer lives, but into our kind of worldview, that the idea that you could find someone. I'll speak from personal experience, truly. I was very hesitant about doing the whole Facebook thing because I thought it seemed to be putting too much of one's personal self out there and worrying about what people say, look what they have access to, and so forth. And yet, as soon as I did start sticking my toe in that water, so to speak, I started finding people I hadn't seen or talked to in 20, 30 years in some cases. And it was, I started to get it. I started to understand what the whole idea of networking was all about. So many of these sites now available, as I'm barely scratching the surface here of what's out there, so much so in terms of both foreign language education and education generally, that 2 years ago, three now, 2010, come on in. Come on, enjoy. There's name tags up here. No, not a problem. We're a tough room to find. But there's some name tags up here. If you register, there's name tags, and if you could sign in here as well, if you want to do the Tumblr thing later on. So that in 2010, the Academy actually begins to focus a lot of attention on this. This is a wonderful volume by Anna Martinez Aleman and Catherine Workman on looking at how social media have crept into the Academy. And it's kind of, rather than summarizing the entire book, there's one particular bit of data that I'm interested from this work, and that was in 2010. 2010 is already 3 years ago. Percentage, I always throw this one out because it stung me when I read it. Are university college students now? And I would say UT is probably model for this statistic. How many hours a week did Aleman and Workman find American high school students on average spent on social media each week? How many hours? You're probably have gotten there by now. It does seem that way. In 2010, the average, so yes, there probably are some of our students who spend 50 hours a week even on it. We're spending 24 hours a week, more than a what we would call a student job. Right, a 20-hour job. So it was quite remarkable, as they commented, how this phenomenon, morning glory, come on in, grab your name tag up here and sign on in, thank you. How this social media phenomenon had not more affected what we do in the classroom. And her contention was, we as educators either needed to accept the fact that students were going to be online that much of the time, and that could be time that they would normally spend on what we would call traditional homework or studying or whatever, or we could try to co-opt social media into our classrooms and try to figure out how best to do something about that. So, enter now my baby for this talk anyway. And actually, I've had the most fun of all the social media that I use in my Russian classes with this one. And I have to start off by acknowledging another speaker today. I'm going to read, actually, I've had an article on this topic published in the last couple of years, so I'm reading directly from the text there simply because I want everyone in the room, especially my partner in crime, Orlando Kelm, to know that this, I've gone on the record publicly now with this initially. It says, my own recent classroom experience in attempting to turn this unstoppable tide of our students' incessant use of social networking technology, especially during our classes, began after a conversation with another foreign language colleague of mine, Professor Orlando Kelm, who'll be hearing from a bit later this afternoon, from Spanish and Portuguese, who was commiserating with me over the growing lack of students' attention in our larger classes due to the use of internet during class. This was back in, I want to say 2010, so this would have been 2008 that we had this conversation. In particular, we were deriding the relative newcomer to the social networking family, an instant messaging site called Twitter. We both joked that any format for personal communication that reduced normal conversation to telegraphic utterances of only 140 characters or tweets signals a certain demise of Western civilization. And my colleague then half seriously suggested the only way we might ever change the culture of the new American classroom was to begin to use this technology as part of our own instruction. We both laughed at the suggestion and then suddenly wondered out loud, well, why wouldn't we? And my colleague, Orlando, countered with, you could use it during your lectures to see what students are thinking. And suddenly, the seemingly ludicrous idea of using Twitter during classrooms became a genuine pedagogical challenge. That fall, I was teaching a course on Slavic vampires, which usually gets about 180 students in it, and I thought, why not to try that? So I began looking at integrating Twitter first into my so-called normal, my regular classes, not my language class, but regular classes. And let's talk a little bit about how what Twitter doesn't do for us. So why use the tweet format to begin with? Why think about this in general, whether we're using this in a class of 150 undergrads, 175 undergraduates learning about Slavic vampires or about Golden Age Spanish literature, whatever, or in our language classes? Well, there's concision, this idea of being concise. Now, as I said, we began this as a derisive comment. What can you really say in 140 characters? I was stunned to find out you can say quite a bit of pithy stuff. And indeed, if you look at the 140 character limit in Twitter, rather than saying, well, what can you say, but rather, how do you say it tersely? How do you really get the message across, what you need to say? Concision, being concise, can have a lot of plus added to it. You can do real-time communication. It is a real-time interactive website. So you can put a tweet out there and immediately have people respond to that tweet or have others join in that conversation. And there it is a multiple user interface. You can have an entire class tweeting on the same subject at the same time. Come on in, there's the name tags up here. Sure. It's terrific, and I'm now kind of jumping a little bit now to why I particularly like it for language classes. It allows for simultaneous turn taking. So that it's almost like being at a cocktail party, where you can be having a conversation with someone face to face, but you know there's another conversation, possibly even more interesting than your own, right down the street. I told you, come on in, this name tag for you.
Okay.
Sorry about that. Seen that one earlier. Thank you. So the idea that you can now have multiple conversations going at once makes it all more fun and actually more realistic. And if you want, if a student wishes, he or she can remain anonymous. So it allows also to put stuff out there without personal attribution. If that's how you either want to run your class or if your student simply wants the class to run that way. I found this little chart very interesting. This is from 2009, so it's a bit old now. I'm curious to see if this has changed much. Twitter itself ran this experiment only a year after Twitter began to happen, to say what was being tweeted about on Twitter. And you'll see kind of the pie chart here of small bits, like a little bit of news, which I found really interesting, that not many people with a lot of news spam, putting stuff out there like our conferences and workshops, right, a little bit of that. A little bit of retweeting, a set sort of, you get something, you like it, so you send it out again. Self-promotion, right? I'm giving a paper today at this great workshop down at UT, right, let everybody know. But what was what are the two biggies? You're right in the middle, right? The red and the blue. Pointless babble. Having lunch right now. It's really yummy.
Or pictures of lunch.
Look at what I'm eating. It looks just like what you're probably eating, right? Or really hot and muggy sticky today in Austin, right? That kind of thing. Or conversation. Leaving right now for UT. I'll meet you up for lunch. I'll see you at about 12. Right, that kind of quick little conversation. So that's what it looked like. Actually, I look at that and go, if this is really what's going on, especially the bits, you know, about things like pointless babble and all, how much could this work in, especially the language classroom? So I worried that, well, conversational, that makes me kind of happy if they're really going to be talking to each other. But I gave it some serious thought. So I tried it out first attempt, in a non-language class. This was right after Orlando and I had this conversation about would this work, would this not work, what's the point, why not, give it a try. And I told my students, I went full frontal. Class had already been going for about a week or two, and I walked in and said, I had this great conversation with a colleague, and I want to try an experiment. Would you be interested in doing this? Let's do Twitter in class. Students went nuts. Yes, 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 let's do it. Does that mean we can bring our laptops? Yes, you realize even when at that point, a lot of them had handhelds. I didn't have a handheld at the time. They all had their iPhones and so forth. So they bring them in. We all signed up to a class Twitter site. And here are some of the, I just brought a couple of just pulled. You can see this is from 2009, the spring. So this will be the spring of the same year we talked in the fall. And things, so I'd be showing the classroom had, so there are 170 plus students in the classroom, seated about 200, I should say, and two screens, right? So I've got one screen on the left that's showing all, your left, would be showing all my slides, whatever PowerPoints, whatever film I might show, whatever I'm talking about is going on. Here I'm lecturing in front, and the other screen had the Twitter feed that's live. So they're just adding on. So as we're going, I'm showing stuff, I'm doing the lecture, and stuff starts to come on. And about every so many minutes, I would turn to refresh the Twitter feed, and I'd look and see. Sometimes there'd be questions about the actual content. So there's, I'm showing a film from a contemporary Russian vampire movie called Night Watch, sort of a sci-fi vampire film. So they didn't have any reason to fight except that neither one wanted to move. It kind of, I'm not following what's going on in the film, and that's kind of cool. That if the student's watching the movie, you need them to know, and they're not figuring out, I want to know that. So this is kind of nice to get the kind of clarification of what's happening. But oftentimes you're going to get commentary. I love this, because this isn't the usual, any questions? Right? Some students, they won't put up the hand. B, they don't often use, because I've asked questions, they won't say, I don't have a question, but I'd like to say something about it. And actually, I realize that I've been stifling a lot of this commentary. So things like fascinating music choice that was being played in the background of this film, it makes the fight seem religious. Well, there was actually a lot of pith to that. There was actually stuff that I could now talk, address as part of my lecture based on these commentaries. Some of it would be kind of tongue-in-cheek humor. Forever the battle with big pointy sticks, because of course it's a lightsaber thing, like in Star Wars, right? So men with their big sticks is what the joke was, so you can have a little bit of jokes. Sunglasses, brightness, loud noises seems like a hangover to me. So some of it is them just being clever. That's how they use Twitter in real life. I don't mind this. The rules, by the way, I meant to say, I said very simple ground rules. Tweet what you like, ask questions, make comments, engage in conversation with each other as you tweet. No obscenity, okay, no obscenity. And no one can make ad hominem attacks. You can't say, you know, Cagerton is an idiot. You can't say that. You can say, I disagree with Cagerton, and why, and then say why. Engage in conversation, but no one can make ad hominem attacks, which is, that's kind of it. So I'm setting a couple of screens. So that was from one section. This is from another. This was from, again, you can tell right away that this was a different film, but they're saying, this is from The Life of Elizabeth Báthory of Hungary, the first historical female vampire. And so, some questions. Does the southeastern idea of eating the heart of a king cobra somehow come from its regional vampire lore? So real questions that, again, the student might raise their hand, or a student who might not raise his or her hand will tweet it instead. Rather than buying a vampire slaying kit, you can totally make your own. My dad and I did that to my mom for Christmas in 1996. Some of them fall into the whatever category, yet they're kind of fun. The rest of the class, of course, is kind of attending to the tweets as they come in, too. Did the teeth move out of the canines because of the relationship with werewolves? There's an interesting one, because in the scene, we see the vampire's teeth grow. It's kind of filmic trick and so forth. Báthory would have loved having her own death count. Again, and what I'd love too is you're going to get, because this was already predicating something interesting to me, was if I do use this in a classroom, things like, you know, either typos or misspellings and all, these are going to occur, and they're going to have to become part of the class. So I'm test driving this thing out before I use it in class in 2010. So you can get an idea here of what happens. So at the end, I'm going to show you how my pie chart is different from the other version. So in 2010, the year after I tried out in Vampires, this was kind of, I viewed this as a kind of cosmic call to arms. Dmitry Medvedev, who was in his last term as president, then last year as president, opened a Kremlin Twitter account. And so I said, well, that does it. If the Kremlin is tweeting, I need to do this in my language classes. And this actually made a really big impact on me. tweeting in a second in foreign language. Or, as I say, the lines in Chirkets. Chirkets is this kind of wonderful, using the sound in Russian, what tweet would sound like in Russian. So Chirkets becomes the term to tweet. So we're going to do tweeting now in the language class. Right away, an interesting little add-on occurred. As I brought Twitter into, and this is an intensive Russian class, so 6 hours will be very, very face-to-face, in-your-face instruction. The students do most of the grammar, vocab work out of class. In class, we're really just going at it. And right away, I introduced Twittering as one of the means of communication for our classes. And by the end of the, let's see, the intensive classes would have been October, so we're actually not far from the time we'd be now in class. About the fourth week of classes, I actually took them to a Russian website that's called How to Behave Yourself, or How to Act When You're in Russian Twitter. Because to me, one of the most essential or important things that bringing the medium that they were already all familiar with, they've been doing in their own lives all the time, but doing it in a Russian context was I wanted them to start to model their tweeting behavior the way a Russian would, not the way an American Texas UT student would. So this is a website, it says it's 10 rules of behavior, how to conduct yourself. And advice for those of you who are just starting out, could this be better? I mean, perfect thing. So the idea here is that right here, doing what you already know, but in now the second language. So you know how to tweet in English, but now you need to do it in Russian. And learning now what's new in the, what you think is familiar, in the second culture. So you think, this is my classic example always, but my wife and I have taken groups to the Oxford program in Britain, and watching students make the false assumption that just because the lingua franca is still English, that everything happens the way it does in America. Well, we're all speaking English, why is it they don't do this? It's because, well, it's not the same culture, and actually not quite the same language either. More so the case in Russian. That just because you're familiar with how to behave on the Twitter website in the States, in Texas, doesn't necessarily mean you understand what's going to be happening if you tweet actively in Russia. So, getting used to that. Now, those of you who do Russian, we're here. Take a look at this website if you get a chance, by the way, iBooks.ru, but I wanted to pull one of the lessons, of the things that they give. Mm-hmm. I love the, so this is the seventh suggestion of what, how to behave yourselves is, do not, get out of the way here, do not whine. Do not whine in your tweet. I have problems too. The cow died, I had diarrhea in the morning, so what? Yes, it's bad, it's terrible, but it's not worth whining about. It's better to write how you'll deal with it. Sweet, yeah. And then, it's in italics, it emphasizes. Anger, however, is not whining. So if you're really ticked off about something, this is worth remembering. It's better that if you really want to write something that, you know, this really upset me, write about what upset you, but don't whine. Don't kvetch, right? My students said, I'll have nothing to tweet about then. That's what I always tweet about. I hate this class. Why am I in this class anyway? I don't know. I'm paying good money for this class and they're making me do homework in it, right? So, in Russian, and it's true, if you go to the Twitter site in Russian, you won't find the kind of, you just don't. It's culturally not done in Russian in public space. Right? It's a different matter. You can whine to your best friend, you can while you're having lunch or something, or walking, having coffee, but in public space, no. You can complain about something, if you're angry about something. I was treated unfairly. This is unjust. The Twitter sphere went nuts recently when the big anti-gay and the whole LGBT controversy in Russia began. People were really ticked off about this, and the Twitter sphere went nuts with people not whining, but really complaining about it. So this is the kind of information I think is really terrific to get the students to know what Twitter is in the other language, you know, what it looks like in the other language. So how did it work? Well, not dip all that differently from the way I would use it in my vampire class. So for example, again, one screen, the video material of the lecture, whatever I was trying to get them to interact with during the Russian class on screen A, and on screen B, the Twitter feed going. So first, let me let you be my students very briefly, 2 minute little clip here. So I show a clip of a relatively contemporary film, 2008, called Peter FM, Peter FM, about a Russian radio station and the woman DJ who's there who loses her cell phone and the handsome young man who finds the cell phone and they actually meet through this. It's a chick flick, yeah, it's kind of a chick flick thing. But it's very sweet, and it's extremely positive. It's one of the few contemporary Russian films that doesn't make, that really does appeal to our young students because the heroes are about their age, but also because it actually gives an extremely positive view of what it's like to be a young Russian in the 21st century. So I show this particular scene early on. This is in, again, this is an intensive class, but so they haven't had a lot of time, but they've had enough to write some a few basic questions. So it's late in the first semester, around November, around the Thanksgiving time. And it has, this scene has very little language in it. A lot of these great clips don't need to have heavy linguistic content because they have the big fat layer of cultural stuff laid on top. So actually, I'm using this not to have the language, as it were, distract them, but to let them focus on the images and tweet about what they're seeing. So let me show you the scene. Here it's just a short little scene. The setting is our hero, who's a university student, has just gotten a contract because he's great, he's an architecture student, and he's gotten a contract from Berlin to leave Russia, to leave Petersburg, St. Petersburg, where he lives, and move to Berlin and become an architect there. All his friends are jealous. Oh, you lucky guy, you're leaving, you're getting out of this country, this is great, this is terrific. He's actually really ripped about this because he loves his city and he doesn't want to leave it, and yet it's more money. But now he's also found this woman he cares about, he thinks he cares about, so there's all that complication. So in this scene, he's simply walking around his hometown, Petersburg, and taking in what it is to be in that incredibly beautiful city. So this is the scene.
Вы слушаете Питер ФМ, все будет хорошо. Я узнавала.
Of course, there would be Russian subtitles for our students. Walks around, you can see older, you know, this kind of lovely 18th century rebuilt city, young Russians and so forth. So the Twitter feed was quite long on this section. Students had a lot to say, but I pulled out to try to give you a quick sense of this presentation just of how the conversation went. So the Russian up there, a few of the selected, kind of tried to sort of really follow, and it's just sort of scary. And I've marked with the asterisk means where there's a little either a spelling mistake or a grammatical mistake here. Ой, он так красивый, мужчина в России, все хороши. So he's so cute, a little grammar error there. All the men in Russia are nice, yes, right? Someone says, so why are there no old people? Only young people in the six. So he's walking around Petersburg, and yeah, it's true. The director Barry Purps, he wants to be in young people's films, right? And Petersburg is like Paris, only Russia. Right? So here, in fact, right away, you can see some of the kind of throwaway sentences, and yet that's an interesting observation because indeed Petersburg was designed by a French architect. Yeah, it turned out. And the question here about why only young people, well, we're talking a little bit about what the director was trying to do and so forth, this actually is going to become part of a dialogue in a minute. So there, someone finds this, literally, yeah, he's hot like the weather is hot. just a little literal translation there, and I love this. Нет iPhone, for I see. Aren't there iPhones in Russia? This is the scene now when it shows that you two, the young couple sitting in the coffee house, and he's taking a picture, and he walks by and kind of starts hitting on her, and that's what's this? What's this? And again, they don't know how to say what they would like to say. He's hitting on her or something. And instead, the student says, "Что это? What's this about?" Она с хорошим человеком. Что она делает? Right? She's with a nice guy. A little grammatical mistake there, but it's understandable. To a Russian, it'd be understandable. Она с хорошим человеком. Что она делает? What's she doing? If she's got a nice guy, why is she hitting on another guy? So a lot of the great, and so what has happened now, how this breaks out, is food for now the next step. We're talking about what they've seen based on the tweets rather than what I think they should see. And interestingly, the entire Twitter follow-up would be to restate. So if there are grammatical or lexical mistakes, they tend not to be big ones. I mean, those who speak Russian yourself, it's comprehensible Russian that they're producing even after a few weeks. It's just got some fine-tuning. So instructor now can, or in pairs, restate what you see in the tweets, so get the right form out, not go through it. Respond any direct questions. So aren't there any old people in Petersburg? Well, of course there are. This was, we talk about the film versus what's really there. Explication of cultural information. So what is it, how does dating take place? Because some people asked about that, about the young couple sitting in the coffee house. What about him coming up and hitting on her? Is that typical? Was that normal? Is that part of the movie? So some cultural information. Continuation of any established dialogues. So very interestingly, we took it further to say, so you thought this guy was, and we correct this to say, so he was attractive rather than say on горячий, on жаркий, on красивый. And what does that mean? And the question, that's a real hard question in any of our languages to answer. So if someone says he's attractive, then say, why? Why do you think that? Because then suddenly they're now, well, look at him, look at him, and they'll say something like that. You know, смотри на он, right? Смотри на него. They'll say, look at him, and they'll start now trying to figure out. I'll freeze frame and say, okay, describe it. And now the Russian starts, right? So now the tweeting, as it were, becomes the basis of the actual language. Yeah, it's fun stuff. And it's incredibly, to use the Russian expression, aktuальный, it's very now, right? It's on at the moment, so it's not like I've gone to a textbook and said, okay, exercise 3 is going to talk about the city. So we're going to go back to the film and find the part about the city. No, it's right at the moment. It's what they just said about the film itself. Now, to continue those dialogues, and that's where the real production starts. We can also then review any new lexical grammatical material in context. So, for example, if they want to talk about couple of students that they want to talk about the buildings, were these European, they look more European, is what the comment was. They didn't look so Russian the way Moscow does, they look European. Okay, so what about, we're going to need a few words here. So they haven't had words of architecture, so they'll get words for Baroque, words for even the term to say 19th century, 18th century, and so forth. So we can do all that new lexicon in context. And I love this, is that we can initiate conversation about the material that was presented now. Because the students, in a way, have told me what they've found interesting or relevant about the particular piece. Here's what's cool about it from a pedagogical perspective. Now look how my pie chart has changed. So what I found was, in doing this now a couple of years, was that largely, and it's almost the same thing that happens in normal native language twittering, about a third of it tends to be a commentary of what's going on. You know, here's what's happening. But then, look, I love this. Questions about the content specific, nearly a quarter. Questions about the culture. These are all in diminishing amounts that we're comparing, and they get pretty much the same. Content, questions about cultures, cultural specific. Questions about grammar. And it'll be, how do you say, or what is, you know, why is it this way? Or she's, especially when there's more language in it, they'll say, why did he say this? Says, I know what he was asking, but why did he say it that way? It's a very simple, and I love it, because I don't pick them up, right? Classic Russian, for example, what is it? Is что это? And in normal quick speech, it's just чё. Чё. And the student hears this meeting, why isn't he speaking it the way you taught us how? And I love it when they do that, so that's kind of cool stuff too. Rejoiners, comebacks, right, to what someone else said, these are all about the same, and then someone just say something cut off, just making a joke about what they saw. So it's changed this again to me to really bring out the heavy commentary content, so the large lion's share of what they're doing, what they're saying on the Twitter site is not throwaway stuff. It's content, it's linguistic, it's language. My 2 years now, I'm in my third year now doing this with the classroom group, is building a really interesting body of data. What I'm finding is students are buying into this right away because it does have a cool factor. Oh, we're not using a textbook, we're using Twitter. This is so great. Twitter, you know, yay, we're gonna forget. I can have my cell phone on in class, yay, so I can be on Facebook when he's not looking. You know, that's all kind of there, it's all in the background. So there is that little factor that we're doing something cool, so it's gonna be fun. But then that falls to the side. And each year it's less of a novelty, actually. I think as more of our colleagues are picking this up, it's becoming a little more commonplace. What I'm finding now is that, thanks to that previous pie chart, is that students know how to use the medium and really adapt quite well of a changing tonality and changing their use patterns when we switch into another culture, another language. At least that's how the movement seems to be going right now. This use of social media combined with things like a Facebook site or a blog site gives our students that. I'm going to go back to what Aleman and Workman said, gives us a chance to co-opt. I'm going for, you know, even if I can get 5 hours out of that 24 hours that they're spending on Facebook or on social media every week, if I can steal 5 of that and have them on Facebook in Russian, on Twitter in Russian, outside of class, that's contact time that's an add-on benefit. So if I'm trying in an intensive format to spend these really, really tight 6 hours a week with them in class, and then giving them a bunch of work to do outside of class, okay, that's still getting me kind of close to what I know is the amount of contact hours they need. But if on their own, they're going to Twitter, they're going to Facebook, I want to hear about how they go to Tumblr, I want to see that, I'd love to see that get added on. They're doing all of this wonderful social media work in the language, all the better for all of us. So I purposely left us an extra 10 minutes here, so comments, questions, complaints, objections, I want it all. Go for it.
Yeah, I have a technical question. Please. Perhaps it might interest other people.
Please.
I use my Twitter in Spanish and Portuguese and in English, and of course, lots of letters missing, right. But we find ways of, you know, going around that. Now I see you using a language with a different writing system.
Yes.
How can
I was just about to say, you can fix that very simply. Yeah. So if you're using, I'm going to speak from the Mac side, Mac or PC?
I have a PC, I have a Mac.
On a Mac platform, it's very simple. Okay. Mac platform is, if you go into your language setting, there's a whole menu of just simply go to Spanish.
Before you go to Twitter, you go there and change the
letter. Let me show you very quickly, so I'll do this in real time for you. It's 2 seconds. Up here, so I have added on, you see a little flag up there, right? So that's American English. I've added on Russian. Okay. So all I need to do is I go, and I added on Russian from Apple's website. I didn't buy anything,
okay.
This is already
yes.
And Spanish is already there. So this is my current, this is my vampire class, so this was in English. But if I wanted to, get my glasses on here, so let's see what I'm doing. Here we go. So there's, there it is. Yes, it's a vampire class, sorry about that. So I want to now compose my new tweet. So I'm about to send my own class a tweet, and let's say for some reason I'm going to do it in Russian. I'll just swap out Russian. I misspelled it, sorry. Should be coaching. There we go. What do you want? I ask. Right?
Okay.
And that's all you do. If I want to do it in Arabic, I plop in the Arabic font.
I never even thought about doing it.
And just drop in, they have one called Spanish, and one called Espanol. And Espanol is the Spanish keyboard. So it would be exactly what you would find if you were typing on a computer in Spain.
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you for asking. It's a good technical question.
A couple of things I've learned along the way. One is you've got to commit yourself to being willing to look at what they tweet.
Yes.
I remember the first time a student said, I know a great YouTube clip that does exactly that. Here's the link. And I remember thinking, you know, I have no idea what this clip is going to have on
That's
it.
Right.
Do I or do I not dare click on it in front of all my students?
Yes.
But, you know, I'd been encouraging them to tweet during the lectures, and it was not my place to all of a sudden be the gatekeeper and go, no, we can't look at that because
exactly.
I haven't seen it.
Exactly.
And so I had to commit myself to, you know, if somebody raises their hand and says, I want to say what I'm going to say out of my mouth, okay. And the same thing with the YouTube clips. I had to take the commitment that, all right, if you're going to share that with me, I think I need to click on it.
You said it exactly as it is.
You know, so that was one thing I learned along the way. The other thing was I've always been jealous that you teach vampire classes.
Right.
I use it in sci-fi. I use it in my other classes.
My students have to comment on the occlusive pronunciation of Budaga, which is not near as exciting
so
as vampire.
About that.
Next comment is, if you use Firefox, Firefox has an add-on which automatically refreshes
yeah.
the thing. And that way you don't have to ever click on a button to refresh your tweets, because it automatically will be refreshed every so often.
Yes.
Right.
Exactly.
And so that's a nice feature.
I use that one. It's very funny. There are times when I kind of have it, I admit that in my, like the vampire class, I like the control over the number of tweets coming across that I can do the, now let's go to the tweets and click refresh or click new, and they all come down. If they're going on ongoing, and this not in the language class. In the language class I use most of all, I use Firefox. I don't in my vampire class because I found that they're paying attention to the new tweets coming in, and they completely now are ignoring the phone. they're not, because normally if they watch and they just tweet everything in, and then I hit and then all the tweets come in, it seems like they're getting, oh, there's all the conversation all of a sudden in front of them. So I think it is a pedagogical choice.
It's one of the options.
It's a pedagogical choice.
And then my final is actually a question is, I haven't used it the last few semesters personally because I'm no longer in classrooms that have two screens.
Right.
And I haven't figured out how to do it in a classroom that doesn't provide me with all the cool things you have.
Actually, no. My sci-fi class only has the one screen. I teach in FAC. And I simply toggle. I put the Twitter feeds on the PC because it's got the two interfaces built in. I don't even bring any computer. I just bring a flash. Twitter's on PC, and my lecture's on my Mac. And I toggle between the two, and I really do. Now we go to the, let's head over to Twitter, and just hit one button, and it really comes up. It's really unobtrusive. Yeah, it's doable. Yeah.
There's a question.
I wanted to add real quick about the content question, and this is more of a story that you could think about our students or something. But I too was very, very concerned. I mean, you can think, but suddenly you say, this is my favorite kind of vampire, and there's a link, and you go, oh dear. And then the class, to their credit, right, start in click it, and they're all yelling, so I click it. I click, because you're right, it's a classroom, you can't control what comes out of your mouth, and sometimes something you don't think is appropriate will come out of your mouth, so I have to look at what's coming out of their tweets. And you click it, and I have, no one has put anything I'll even say marginally offensive up there. Have they put things that are completely irrelevant to what I want to talk about? Of course they have. And of course they put silly things or fun things. Often they put very smart things up. They will put a piece of video or a little short clip, a YouTube thing that's really right on the mark. So to their credit, I have, you know, I'm going to find something good here. I have not yet clicked on something and then gone, oh my God, what have I done? The good news is you can also then very quickly shut, close the screen if it were to be something horrific. But I haven't had to do that yet, so that's why. Yes, please.
That's one freedom that the university you have that in the high school.
You're quite right.
I could not do that.
You're quite right. And so I don't know if you did the same kind of thing of saying when you set your ground rules for use, would be, and you may not attach images or URLs. Just say, when you're tweeting, please keep your tweets to words. Don't add any attachments of any kind. And just make it as a ground rule. Yeah? Because I think actually high school kids would take really get into this. I think they would get into this. And if you just say, look, I'm not gonna open any attachments, don't put anything on there, just keep it words. To me, that's pretty straightforward. Yes, please.
Our department has a policy of no technology in the class, classroom. So the engaged student, is the contribution is clearly going to be really good for the already engaged student. But if the student is intent on being distracted in class, to what degree is that derogatory for him and the other students around him?
I know it's happening in my sci-fi, in my vampire class. I've never come across it in my language classes. The language class states the students really do, it's an intensive class. They don't have time to go on to, let me check my mail now, that kind of thing, or just be surfing. In my big lecture classes, I'm positive some students are abusing it. And I don't know, part of me wants to throw up my hands. I'm just saying I don't know that I could do anything if the materials were any other kind of material. If they were supposed to have the book open and they would instead, you know, have the book with a magazine inside of it, or reading the paper, or whatever they do, they're going to do that too. So it's just to be a different way of not paying attention. The student who's saying, I'm just not going to pay attention, is going to do it in his own or her own way. I did find in the last 5 years the prohibition, the kind of do not bring, you are not allowed to bring in, really troubling. It troubled me first as just kind of a civil liberties question, but it troubled me really in the kind of academic integrity question. It's part of, to me, an honor code issue of saying, you know, what am I going to do next on what not to put in their backpacks? You know, do not bring, bring only academic books, don't bring any other kind of literature. And to me, it's sending the distractions of distraction. And if we can use different views, the cell phones or the laptops, iPads, whatever it is, as part of the class, then we kind of, in a sense, defeat them with their own instrument, right? I think. So I'm not sure, I don't know. I thought my wife and I both did this kind of, do you just prohibit this? Because you know some kids are up on their own Facebook pages or checking their email. And then, yeah, we thought, no, can't do it, because then what about the students who really do want to use it for the class, to do something in class? So, I think there are a couple of students, two comments here on the
same. I think you made a really good point that students are distracted and who are going to be off task are going to be off task no matter what. So if you can't really, punish the rest of the class for what's going on.
Especially if they're using it as well as they are using it.
Exactly.
It's a kind of a double whammy. Telling them that you can't bring your laptop in. And by the way, you're not going to get the benefit
of using the laptop.
They are emerging events in the college.
Yes.
At what point do we say, if you're going to just let yourself be distracted, there's no consequences for that?
Absolutely. Especially in something like a language class. Your language isn't going to be there, right? Exactly. It's not going to happen at the end of the term. I like that. I mean, ultimately, we kind of have this wonderful instant proof, proof in the pudding kind of thing. So, how did that Spanish thing work out for you? Oh, I see. You can speak Spanish now. That's quite good. Or, you don't know a damn thing, do you? Did you do anything in class? Right. Yeah. Okay. Yes, sir. Thanks.
How do you integrate students that maybe don't have like Twitter accounts on their computers? So I have students that don't really
Yes.
with technology.
Yes.
How do you address that?
In my language class, I have to admit, I I'm a little bit more Machiavellian, because I'll say is, I strongly advise you. I wouldn't say, I can't say, you have to do this. I come close. I write it into the syllabus to say, portion of the class is going to be conducted on social media sites. If you do not have a social media site, I strongly advise you to get one. If you don't wish to have one, then you can participate in the traditional raising of the hand during the discussion part. So some students, in the big classroom, no, I don't, I'm not about to tell a student who has an oral objection to Facebook or Twitter that now you need to do that. I'm not going to do that. So usually I get about, because it's really funny, when we do Twitter, I ask them to, they follow me, I follow them. So I know exactly how many in this big, massive classroom are doing it. It comes to right around 60-70%. We'll right away go, this is cool, I want to do this. And then the number of actual users that I can kind of track by their online names and so forth is probably close to 50%. So some will go on just to kind of read what everyone else is saying, but not actually contribute to it. Yeah.
So you use Twitter outside of the classroom as well, and so what kind of prompts do you?
So I'll often put out things there for the next class, for those who are actually following the class, just to get them to think about whatever I've assigned as a reading. Sometimes they watch something, a film or something. Is I'll put out a comment that I meant, just finished rereading such and such. And I was reading chapter 7 of Bram Stoker's Dracula. Did you notice online, whatever, he invokes and does, he invokes Texas. There's a whole section there on the crazy Texan that's coming into Mina Harker. It actually is in there, but Bram Stoker had this kind of not very pleasant view of the state of Texas back in 1897, thinking that there's the United States, barbarian, but then there's Texas, very barbarian, but very rich. And that's what it is. He's a rich, rich, oafish Texan who comes in with his big knife, his big knife that he wields ultimately. So absolutely, I'll kind of tease them about what's coming up in the lecture next time. And I'll get responses to it. I mean, I don't want to get to where my wife and I both do this for our classes, and we have very different constituencies in our classes. She teaches in comp lit. And boy, it's really funny. The quality, not just quantity, but the quality of tweets is so different depending on what class you're teaching. So yeah, I think our prompts help a lot to move that conversation. Yeah?
I have a question about a different kind of instruction. Sometimes when students are posting something, yeah, especially in class, they're really concerned about what they're going to say, they're going to keep thinking, like, oh, what am I going to say, how am I going to say, so they get distracted from the actual the content that's being given to them.
Yeah.
I was going to ask you, what kind of scenario, like what situation would you use in class so the content that you give them is in class?
I think your point is right on the money, by the way, and yet pedagogy goes back to literature on that very question. If you take the word tweet out, goes back to the 19th century. John Dewey talks about this, that our students in language class in particular is talking about, not that kind of content, are constantly being distracted from, our mouth is moving, as teacher, and they're hearing nothing because they're thinking, nominative case, okay, fine, the verb, I need present tense, because they desperately want to ask a question about something I just said, but their mind will now shut down for about 20 seconds while the question is formulated, so that she doesn't make a fool of himself or herself by asking the question. And so that process to me is going to go on regardless. Now what I have noticed, this is not scientific at all, this is very anecdotal, but what I've noticed is that students right away, you can watch them in their faces, they're watching something on screen and you watch the light bulb, I've got something to say about that. There's something that really, I've got it. And you watch them quickly go to the keyboard and they go. It's like a brain dump. I think, anecdotally, they do more just spit it out on the keyboard than they do before they ask a question in front of class. They're much more afraid, and I'm saying this in the most positive pedagogical way possible, they're more encouraged to make mistakes, which is a wonderful part of language learning, on the keyboard than they are orally. In class, they're much more reticent to say something wrong, to get the pronunciation wrong. That's the other thing, they don't have to worry about pronunciation, their keyboard again. When we get to the follow-up, we talk about it, so they do ultimately have to say it out loud. But they tend to just quickly brain dump. So to me, the distraction time is actually less on Twitter than it is when they're just sitting there thinking about what they want to say.
So what scenarios would you use Twitter while watching movies?
I should put for film clips. I mean, they can tweet anytime they want, but I you know, during class. But they tend to do it. I watch and you can see when they're coming in. During film clip, I'll be playing a listening, just an audio track. I might put a text up on the board, or, you know, on the screen that came up, you know, literally a small part of an article from today's newspaper or something, just a follow the website, Muskoska problem, something like that. And just say, take a look at this, you know, give me some quick answers, you know, what's it about, who's it about, who's, you know, what's it in reference to, what's your opinion on it, and then boom, boom, boom. Tweets come up, and then we can talk about it. Then we can go from the written form to the oral form. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you. This, I just love this, by the way.
Yeah. Thank you.
So my question is, the scene that you showed us in Petersburg,
yes.
And then the tweets were running. That scene about intermediate level students, like those mistakes and that level.
The mistakes would be actually they be novice. They're kind of novice high mistakes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
They've moved now from memorized phrases to creating a few new phrases on their own. So they're novice high to intermediate level. Yeah.
But the class itself was.
The class now at that point should be exactly at that cusp between novice and intermediate. That's where it should be by the time we got to that point in the class to be able to make those statements. Yeah. The intensive class, to their credit, they do pick up stuff fast.
Have you used that at all in the beginner class?
Yeah, this is a beginner class. This is a beginner class. I was a beginner class. Just intensive.
Okay.
So that by the time we get to October, late October, November, we're well into past mid-year of what the normal first year class. Yeah, we're like a midterm at the end of semester one. Yeah. Yes, ma'am, let's get one last question, please.
It is my experience that nowadays American students,
yes,
in a foreign language course are doing much better writing and probably reading than speaking and understanding. And however, they want very badly to,
yes,
to like speak.
Yes.
And if we're going to spend all this time, you know, for them tweeting and all that, which is actually a writing exercise.
Yes.
What happens to this communication in class, answering questions, conversing, all that stuff?
See, I think Twitter allows, like blogs, allows for a moved into an interesting new place. Because I was a huge communicative competence junkie moving into the proficiency movement, and I was one of those who very quickly said, oh, let's just dismiss all this nonsense about writing in class because they're not going to do that. That's not what they do. They want to speak, they need to listen. And I've kind of now backed a bit on that to the extent that I see tweeting and blogging much more conversational, even though it's writing. It's getting a chance to kind of put the words out there. We still do all the talking about it afterwards. And indeed, what they're responding to is listening. It's listening and visual. It's both what I call watching comprehension and listening comprehension. The clip I showed purposely because I didn't know how many Russian speakers I had in the audience, and putting up captions, how many distractions could I put on the screen, I want it to be very visual. So I do show that in class, but that was specifically for cultural content, to get them to understand the context of being in St. Petersburg. Normally they're hearing, they're working on listening, and they'll be speaking a lot as well. It's just trying to get them in a sense to put together cogent thoughts that are grammatically, lexically, I keep using the word cogent, meaning they'll have mistakes in them, but a native speaker will understand them.
So after a short exercise with that Peter, then you engage the class with
that's right.
A discussion,
that's
or discussion.
Right. Absolutely. That's, you know, so going down that list of, you know, first thing you do is you address.
And
then
there's some statements, something.
Well, actually, I usually go back to the clip because I'll see something, one of the tweets they say, like when they talked about the guy being pretty. What do you mean he was hot? What does that mean? So I'll go back and I freeze on his face so they can see it. So describe him to me, talk about it. So it very quickly moves into communicative, right, talking about things, getting them to talk, but it's on the basis of what they have instigated. It's very student-centered, actually, because they've now said, I found the guy cute. Tell me about that. What makes him cute? Is it because he's blonde? Because he, you know, what if he were older? Do you still find him cute? That kind of thing. And you just play with them back and forth, back and forth. Did you find him cute? What about you? And what about her? Did you think she was cute? you know, do they make a good couple? And then we start quickly going into future tests. So what's going to happen now? What happens after this? So they're having a cup of coffee. What happens then? Who's going to pay? Well, cultural convention, you'll pay. Where do they go after that? Maybe they'll go to a movie. Oh, really? What do you people see? Okay, from just that little short view, what, you know, and this huge conversation happens on whatever they seem to focus in on. And it changes every single class, by the way. I can teach the same clip to three different classes, and they will focus on different things in the clip. So, other thoughts come to you, please, tweet them to me. I will answer them immediately, or just zap them. That's why I put my email address up there. Please do. Thank you so much for both your attention for the presentation, for the incredibly great questions you gave. So thanks so much. Thank you. So, move us to our next speaker. Keep us relatively on time here. Vince, did you need to use this laptop? Perfect. Okay, good deal. So let me introduce my very, very dear colleague now. I actually use the term here. Dr. Vince Vanderheiden is from our Department of Germanic Studies, where he teaches an incredibly both innovative in the sense of it being a kind of version of the intensive course, a popular course in Dutch language. He was a graduate in our language programs here, and now is a lecturer in our Department of Germanic Studies, and our students are getting the benefit of his expertise and everything else that he offers us here. My pleasure. So we swap this out? Yeah. In your PC, right there. That's actually easy to move on. There you go.
Get started.
Why? What got me started thinking about Tumblr? Well, this spring, a couple headlines crossed my news feeds about Tumblr and caught my eye. The first one, it was a study is a survey of media usage, specifically social media. And the question was, what do you use regularly? Take a look at that. There's about 1,000 respondents. Now, there are some sampling questions. This was, the survey was sort of a splash that comes up before you access certain websites. And so, there's not a lot of control there, and it was sort of self-selecting. But still, this made lots of headlines. Because Tumblr usage among these age sets seems to be higher than Facebook.
It seems strange that for all of them, though, the 13 to 18 group exceeds the group, the next age group. That's stunning.
It really sort of stopped. And so there is another one. The Pew Institute does a yearly survey on internet usage. And they're much more rigorous in their sampling methodologies. And this is a portion of their finding about Tumblr. But the question for Pew was, do you ever use these things? Not do you use them regularly? Okay. So, of course, Facebook's projects in all age groups, all categories, gender, everything. And you can see Tumblr usage is pretty low, 6%. But take a look at the 18 to 29 people. 13% compared to all the other age categories. There seems to be something happening in the younger age group with regards to social media usage and specifically Tumblr. Lastly, in the late spring, these headlines came up. I know you saw that, but Yahoo bought Tumblr for $1.1 billion. I think the number was approximately 12 times their current revenue. And the headlines, as you can see in the two numbers, also, this did not just catch the American English language. So I started having a lot of money. I need to thank Tom for working on this talk today to really start thinking about the new. I have other projects going on. Let's work on this one. So that's what I would like to do with you today, to sort of introduce you what Twitter is, and then ask what Twitter can do, sorry, not Twitter, Tumblr can do for us. And I'm still wondering whether Tumblr is that, or whether it is the next big thing. Is it a flash in the pan? and if it's not a flash in the pan, if this does seem sustainable, what do we do about it? How do we co-opt? How do we appropriate their attention? How do we meet them where they are and use what they do to their language? It's just they come up. So this is where I'd like us to go today. Also, and this is always the question, is it the task or is it the tech? Are we going to let the tech drive us and what we do in the classroom? Or are we going to be aware and deliberate in our classroom? And appropriate. So these two things are going to be hanging in the background of what we do today. Talked about a little bit that this is what we're going to export Tumblr, what it is. Consider what its core needs are, what the understanding of the issue is, and then reflect on opportunities and possibilities. If you've heard this speak, you've seen a video of me speaking the last 2 years. We'll hear me talk about this piece of teaching, which is about instructional design. It's a simple concept. But it goes back to what do we want from the classroom first, and then what are we going to do about it? What are the choices for creating these activities, otherwise, tools, and so I wanted to know from you, I want you to talk about first, what are you looking for? What kinds of ideas are you looking for? Are you looking for language proficiency? Are you looking for ideas how social media can help us with cultural learning, developing intercultural contexts, community building in your classrooms or beyond? Are you looking for an informal learning initiative? Are you looking for something that is not on this list? Think about that for a second, and then I'm going to talk to each other. And then we'll bring that into it. So this is my background design. We start off with the language learning. Yeah. Just talk a little bit. I'm going to be part of it. That's generally about a great amount of time for the conversation just to get going, so I'm going to stop up there. And I'm going to bring you back. I'd like to hear from you. What did you all talk about? What are you looking for today?
We talked a lot about community building or team building part because of trying to get students to, even if it's within a class, several one or several smaller groups, to keep using the language.
Right, good. Community building so that we can get students beyond, outside the classroom talking and using the language and producing. Absolutely.
Even if they're not, I'm 27 years old, if they're not in the second language immediately, they're still engaging and thinking about it and feeling like
it's a conversation. That's right. Yeah, absolutely. What else did you talk about? We had a great desire for finding ways to build community and extend the classroom outside of our walls. Yeah. What else have we got?
Well, I've been teaching, started with summer elective, teaching again online. The next year, we're going to have other things to do. I want to teach the online language classes. So far, I am very blessed. I've taught wonderful books that come about the material. So I can teach asynchronic classes. I put the material there to do the study, and then I say, receive things from them, messages, and so on. But they go on one-on-one. I haven't incorporated the chat yet, because these are many language students. But because I want to start constructing cultural classes, advanced language, and also literature classes, I want to start building into the classes some more synchronic elements without using what we have on Facebook, the Connect, which I find extremely cumbersome, and students, they don't like it, and I don't like it either. So I was thinking that maybe one way we can get around this problem, not using that cumbersome thing, is using Twitter, Tumblr, or whatever else you can come up,
exactly. Right, yeah, so these networking platforms that help make those connections.
One more?
Yeah.
In
addition to what I mentioned about bridging the gap of social connections, especially with Arabic, for instance, it's hard to develop an authentic connection to context with limited opportunities for study abroad and so forth. Secondly, I find that project-based learning is really motivating for students. Mm-hmm. And they can track progress over time, and we have a final product to be proud of, which I might call a celebration of knowledge. And with something like Tumblr, I feel like that can be a tool for an ongoing project and incorporating more project-based learning in the language.
So it sounds like you're almost thinking of a sort of way to curate the production, almost in the sense of a portfolio.
Yeah, it can serve as a self-assessment tool and serve as for feedback.
And something that you can scroll back and see.
Motivational or motivation to see progress.
Great. I would argue that Tumblr helps us do really all of this. Okay. Tumblr is really what we make. That's all of my reason. We'll get there. So, about microblogging, we looked at Twitter already as one of the prototypes of microblogging. And if any work has been done on studying microblogging in the classics, what are the characteristics of it? Generally visual and or short, textual, and it's convenient. Or above all, I think it's convenience. The convenience that has set microblogging away, apart from regular blogging. Regular blogging, it's very much a writer's process. And it's generally not. Microblogging is, here's my thought. Oh, I saw this picture, this is really cool. Let's post it, because somebody else is going to find it. Was it similar to different? How's it being used? Similar, microblogging is similar to blogging, but it's very, it can be very short. It makes you be very short. We're going to find that Tumblr, even though it's supposed to be micro and short, there's nothing that says it can be. How's it different? The social aspects are rather different. Social aspects of microblogging seem to be far more developed than on traditional blogs, in one sense. And how's it being used out here? And well, first of all, you can see the age group is different. Okay, and what tends to happen is that microblogs tend to be very visual. Sharing pictures, sharing animated GIFs. This composes a large amount of specifically. Have you microblogged? Even on the Twitter accounts?
Mm-hmm. Twitter accounts.
And that's, I'm not talking about language context yet. I'm just going to context, but in your I would say Facebook is a microblog.
Before Facebook, I used MySpace.
This is social network sites run in parallel to have a lot of features in common with more or less exclusive microblog sites, or sites that are built from more than that. So Facebook is very much that. So, what is this? Yes, there's no E, just like Flickr, which is now also the Yahoo property. Okay, let's take a look at what I This is the Tumblr dashboard. This is a feed. It's like on Facebook. As you can see, the top is for posting. So the priority is posting. Posting all kinds of things. Text, photos, posts, news, chats, publicly, everything. Just also note though, text and posts, that's the word-based kind of nature of the platform. Everything else is generally much more user. There's a place for managing and administrating. And then the feed is for posts from blogs, from Tumblrs that you have linked. So you have linking here too. And you don't have to stop. We have linking. We have reblogging. We have a number of features that are very social. We talk about that. This is just an idea of what we're talking about before we get it forward. So this is sort of your home site. Now, this is just for you as the Tumblr user. Your Tumblr automatically comes with your Tumblr blog. And this is the way that we set up. That's set up for us. And co-opted the Tumblr. And what you can see is the nature of the Tumblr blog is what looked like almost WordPress of things that I have either created or I have appropriated. I've seen them elsewhere and said, I like this, let's do it and show it. So, these are links to two sites. This is one that Orlando has created, this account, and then this is the link to the TLC's website. I have a few quotes, this is the one we opened with. And then I thought this one, the nature of today's theme of social networking, yeah. If we can't connect, what do we have? But again, this is, I like that, and I just posted it here. Yeah. That's one of the characteristics, key characteristics of Tumblr. Some images. And then this is from somebody else's Tumblr, and it is actually of an interview that Orlando did for the site. So again, we just referenced, we reblogged it. Okay, instead of retweeting something on Twitter, we reblogged it. This is, you could think of this as a scrapbook, you could think of it as a collage. But this is sort of what Tumblr does. Now, I'm well over 23. So you'll notice I only have one image. Now, this is the site, this is the global longer the site from which I took the podcast. But this person's Tumblr is simply, it's a collection of podcasts. So this is virtually all on this collection. This collection is almost all text, okay. But the interest is very much in SLA and grammar, and sorry, for the listeners. And then these blogs are somewhat more traditionally Tumblr-ish, that is to say, they are visual, they are images. These are not the images that 18-year-old children put up. You can look at those. Do a search on Tumblr for highlight. Okay. It won't do that here. But this is one other sort of Tumblr. Another one. Sharing an interest in Tumblr. So, but look at how big the images are. Yeah? It shows you the dominance of visual in this format in this meeting, if we wanted to. But like I said, Tumblr is what we make it, it seems. It's exceedingly flexible. And so does the tech drive the task, or does the task drive the tech? If the young cadre of Tumblr users is predominantly visual, does that mean we have to be in the line of sight? No one has a different use to use it. I've seen people in history, papers, several pages long. So, the point being, Tumblr is very impressive. We'll get to setting things up a little bit. So, just to go back to this, Tumblr is a big problem. Tumblr is open and it's closed. It's long form and it's short form. It's text and it's media. It's authorial, that is to say, it can be one specific author with the best author's tastes, or it can be collaborative. It is original content. It is repurposed content. Repurposed, appropriated, stolen, shared, choose your word. But it is all these things, which makes it exciting, but also makes it fun. And if you feel daunted, that's okay. That's what we're going to have to do. So as we said, it's highly flexible. And the micro part at the bottom is to be done. Okay. So as we said, we have content delivery on the one hand. Posting. Like not on the digital. Like Twitter is, like Facebook was. But we also have content connections. This is the social aspect. We can follow up blogs. We can like posts. We can reply to posts depending on the settings. We can ask questions. A lot of blogs, Tumblrs have ask me anything sections. You can submit posts on collaborative blogs, which is what our blog is. Providing me with your email and when I give you an invitation, you'll be able to submit your own posts to this blog. And you can send to him. So, I think that's a lot of information for now. Let's take a look at setting up your own computers. So, if you have a laptop and you accept my invitation, regardless of whether you receive my invitation, go ahead to tumblr.com. With no E. And this information is also on the back of the I'm logged in now, so you're not going to get the same screen that I have. And I regret that you not take a screen and capture the entire page. So, gumblr.com. And you should have a window, a box, with your name, with requests an email, a username, and a password. Is that correct? So if you'd like to participate, go ahead. And that's all you need to create your Tumblr. So go ahead, create your Tumblr. you'll be able to go to the next steps without even checking into your email to copy the email confirmation. You'll get a bar up top that says, just a reminder, you'll have to do this when we get to it. I've noticed that the response changes depending on the number that you put in.
Yes, I agree. Yeah, it was very rude.
You should have at some at one point a blank screen that says follow some blocks. If you've logged in, is that the case? Yeah. Like that, exactly. There should be a sort of a very blank looking screen at the top of which says maybe follow some blocks. That is your dashboard now. Okay, and as you like some, as you like tumblers, for example, the one for this brief, which is listed at the top of the worksheet, UT Social Network, UT Social Language.
Okay.
You, as you like blogs, you will get posts in your feed on your dashboard. Now, depending on the email or what the email from the Tumblr said, you are already part of the UT Social Language Tumblr, or Orlando, you already accepted the invitation. Did you just click a link and sign for an email?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Inside that email of the invitation, there should be a link. Click that link, and you'll be part of that network. That means that you can post directly to our blog now, our Tumblr. Okay? So you can put up a quote that I have said already and say, this was brilliant. You can be looking at something else and pull that into the page. You can contribute to the page as I have contributed to the page. Okay? What we can do is get back to you. And we can post something. Just for the sake of brevity, we can say, Tumblr, it's awesome. Is what we say something, Tumblr is. This can be like the cartoons, love is dot dot dot. And we can simply and we can tag it so we can organize it and sort it. And then we can publish it. So now
thank you.
as opposed to the home log of my account. That takes us to somewhere else.
So how do you take us to the UT? Only appears there.
We have to choose this part. So let me do this again. That's the one that I forgot. So we'll do. And then here is where we specify that which of our thunders is posted to. Okay. And then it will appear. And now what you can do is you can start liking these posts. You can start reblogging them to your own personal Tumblrs. Okay? And you can do that with any Tumblr that you find, any Tumblr feed that you encounter.
But if you can't Tumblr,
Tumblr
feed,
there is a direction with Twitter, with Facebook, and another site.
You can use that. Mine as well, by the way.
See what you mean? Did you post that directly to here or to your page and share it with us?
I posted directly to the UT social.
So, we'll get to the sharing with other services in a second. I want to see if I can help somebody as I can. Consider a post, or consider reacting to a post while we do that. Okay? And start generating, we're going to get there in a second. Start generating ideas. I'm sure ideas already gestating in your head. Start with you. Okay. That is to share with other people.
Give you?
That is to reblog. And then the heart is can only work with all of them after a certain time.
Thank you. I heard it.
I don't like to be this. I'm trying to like this. Yeah.
This is for
those are my sweet potatoes.
Your sweet potatoes.
Yes, Lord.
How do you say sweet potatoes? Do we have any?
Patatas dos.
Patatas dos.
But, you know, they're like, they're so culturally different.
I know.
You know, squashes and potatoes, you can have the right word for this whole different thing. This is talking about logs. A feature of logs is the ability to post asynchronous comments related to the argument. Written responses, comments, responses. An affordance of this feature is that learners and tutors can provide feedback. An affordance is that it provides an opportunity for formative feedback on the meeting. So the affordances are essentially how we want to appropriate the features of any technology. We could talk about the phrases of the language, in contrast to the phrases of the paper, and do it as so we can, what I would like to do is sort of work through some possible affordances of Tumblr. And that's what the other side of your handout, which is about. I've listed a number of the features of Tumblr. How do you think, what are the potentials for these features in your language classroom? And maybe think about what you said when you came here, or at the beginning of the presentation, when I asked what you were looking for. Talk to each other. Talk to each other a little bit. I think we have 10 minutes. Take about 5. Okay? Take about 5. There's that too. Yeah?
Let's stop.
Okay.
Exactly. What's possible here? Take about 3 to 5 minutes to talk about the issues.
Everything is in the world.
phones, pictures, so we got rid of everything, all the other apps.
I also know that
But what I'm saying is, if I ask, but if I am to include somebody or humble somebody, my mother has a discussion with me. How about we have time for maybe one share? Any great for an affordance of any of the features on the topic?
The Tumblr founder asked me, what about the dinosaur? Which I could think of a way to put my forward maybe to port level students to go on the discussion. One of my goals is for them on Fridays to be able to have in our 45-minute class to do a parliamentary style debate.
Okay.
On topics that we've either discussed the last week, or if I talk about something and I have a week to learn the relevant vocabulary.
Absolutely. So the importance is that a particular feature allows for asynchronous communication outside of the classroom, and as well inside. But that would be the focus. What feature do you think allows, what would you say allows for that?
It looks like it would be both the video, the citation, audio if they want to come in.
So yeah, it's this possibility to have to post content and then contribute responses. Good.
I'm a junior high teacher, and so very basic levels of language acquisition. I really see this not necessarily as an assignment or expecting all of my students to participate, but what I am thinking about is this would be an awesome forum for those students who, what we call the gifted and talented students, those who want more, who want to explore more, because it's really hard to reach those students within the classroom when you have all those different levels. And so I'd like to really explore this and make use of this for them as an extra.
For people in schools, I would encourage you to check on this security program.
Right.
There's a lot of time where I was in the first course. Simple searches, potentially innocuous terms, can be interesting. I think given the prevalence of the age group, that age group's usage.
All your work, can you hear, several people can hear what you're saying? Because I noticed that it has the audio, or...
Yes, yeah.
So you engage several people in the same, conversation?
The audio here is more posting an audio clip.
Oh, okay.
So, conceivably, you could record a prompt. Record a prompt, and then they could record their own prompts and post those prompts. They could record their own videos of the direction, role plays, and post them. Yeah. we have course management software at UT, and especially with Canvas now, it sort of obviously needs some of this. But if you, especially if you don't have course management software, your schools and your situations, it's great to mention.
Doing the short audio files actually is really simple for the students to do a kind of speech sample, save it, and post it as their own audio file.
I would like, the time is fleeting, and I know that many of you are thinking about lunch already. And half of you is Italian, so I am right there with you.
We have a long lunch period, so
What I would suggest, I think this discussion of features and affordances would be great for our public. I would suggest that when you post, I would encourage you to post, and when you do, consider tagging your posts with affordances, for example, or language learning, affordances language learning. I haven't come up with a really good, concise tag that we could use for all of us, but it would help us sort of sort what we're doing, and it would be searchable then for us to use the first.
I'm sorry, can you repeat that?
Sure. Give some examples? No, that's all right. All of Tumblr's posts can be tagged. Okay, later categorized.
Right.
Yeah. And those tags are searchable.
Are they hashtag tagged?
They're hashtag tagged, yeah, exactly. All right, in fact.
Oh, I see. I see it right over there.
Okay. Yeah. So I just typed in the number, the term, and it hashtagged it for me. It's a great way of organizing things for your classes, for us. So I would suggest that when you, that if you post, I would encourage you to post on your blog and have this conversation about that. Because I have not found a lot of people talking about Tumblr in the world of Tumblr. There are a few, and I have some resources for that slide of the presentation. But I think this is a conversation that we need.
I'd like to make a plug for something that might continue the importance of collaboration that you mentioned in your presentation. NPR did a story on this. It's called ZapChat.
ZapChat.
Yeah. So high school teachers and administrators in a region at a certain time zone started something on Saturday mornings called ZapChat. So at Saturday morning at 7 a.m. using hashtag ZapChat on Twitter, they share ideas on what's working for them in their classrooms. They share challenges. They have a 1 to 3 hour conversation that can go on all day if they want, but teachers who want to collaborate outside of their town and state can just get onto Twitter and ask questions and so forth. And it'd be great to see something that was like L2 Sesh at UT or something, or hashtag Arabic teaching ideas or something. To have a time like that, and that idea has taken off to where each time zone now has, at 7 a.m. in each time zone, there's a group of educators that get on to discuss and collaborate.
That's a great idea.
Chat?
Like Saturday chat.
And that's a Twitter hashtag. It'd be interesting to know where it is. Notice that as you type tags, if it already exists in the ecosystem, you can work on it. So you can relate to those and set those on the screens. Okay. So we've talked about, we've explored very quickly, very briefly, what is possible. Just scratch that surface. Some of the things the topics that we talked about earlier, possible ways of prompting community and interaction. Post an idea, image, clip that exemplifies your takeaway from the lesson. A great way of wrapping up and engaging. A lot of these things could be
could be prompts for Twitter in their in the classrooms as well. Post discoveries. This is informal learning. This is personalizing the learning. We talked about portfolios. I think this is a way to curate that. Students have their individual Tumblrs. They invite you to participate or follow. And this is a very great way of doing that as well. Language and course promotion. This is a way of getting the word out. Facebook pages as well, Twitter feeds as well, Tumblrs, class Tumblrs. I think that this is a great way of getting students to practice seeing if we're interested in intercultural development. Being able to see and describe without evaluating. It's like, oh, that's weird. Simply to describe what you see first. I think to a degree, I think Tom's going to get to that is in the interrogation of the he's hot cat competition. Language. This is just, these two ideas came from a source in my bibliography. It's actually a very good source. Penny found it at the end. It's very small. But this author provides a number of possibilities for using it. So that's a brief introduction. There's a lot to look at Tumblr, but I think it's exceedingly adaptable and could lend itself well to our classrooms, especially in the near future, if this is not just a question. Thank you.
Did you want to take a few questions?
We can, absolutely. Yeah.
A few questions, yeah, please.
Well, Cindy, I did want to see the definition of affordances again,
sure.
If you don't mind putting that on the board while.
So you hinted at the viral nature of image sharing on Tumblr, a lot of my drawing is visual. How do you see the meme phenomenon benefiting language learners?
I think on the one hand, there is the opportunity for cultural exploration. Is the meme phenomenon the same in the various cultures that it appears in? Are memes the same? Do memes address similar phenomena? And then also there's the creative side, create your own memes. There's this idea of playing with language. I think the meme is a very interesting way of playing with language. I think that we could get this would be an opportunity for students to create their own memes and then put them out there. But the idea that, I think this goes also back to the Twitter, Washington versus Twitter in the US, are Arabic memes. To what extent are Arabic memes, for example, similar or different from memes in the US? Do they mean the same thing? Do they mean about the same things? Just to concern. I have found that my two languages, the challenge is finding means to serve as bias. It's very easy to find English language means, but it's hard for me for some reason to find Dutch and German means. It's not to say that means don't exist. They absolutely do. But those are the means. But I think it's a very important thing.
Any other questions? What's your own prognosis, for lack of a better word? You clearly want to be doing this in your class. How would you, can you even think of conceiving a start of a
Sure. Do this, and what would your, like, walk in and say, guys, everyone's going to log out and make a Tumblr account and start from there?
Yeah, I think I would like to do a class Tumblr first.
Right.
And I think one of the things that I immediately am drawn to is the idea of cultural exploration. And I, two summers ago, when we took a group of German students to Wurzburg for a summer study abroad experience, I used the Lescamp model of cultural exploration.
Say that sounds so good.
Yeah. So, the SCAMP is an acronym, and it is a way of conceiving of culture and interacting and thinking about the culture around us. The acronyms, let's get L for language, A,
E for environment.
Let's get E for environment, S for social organization, C for context, A for
authority. Authority.
Authority. N for nonverbal, and T for time. An example of this, is environment. This is a view of Würzburg from the hill on one side of the city. If you notice, there is this green strip, all the way around, and this is the river, and it goes from this side of the river all around the entire old city to the other side of the river. My question from the students is, why did they just decide to like the semicircular part? And why does it separate the old city from newer development in this 19th century? What's going on? This is really the footprint of the old city wall. There's even no European cities, this happened a lot. It's a century ago, the walls were coming down. And this wall was 15 meters long. So, we see this remnants of the past in the present. We see the way the city's organization reflects its organization in the past. But the repurposing has also changed the dynamic of the city. This is probably the park. It's a great respite from the heat of the sun. And so, this is what the Lescamp model wants us to do in each of these categories. So hashtagging Lescamp language, hashtagging Lescamp environment, hashtagging Lescamp social organization, on the top of the blog, the class's top of the blog, posting pictures and providing an explanation, I think is a great way of doing that. I tried to do that with the class's Facebook page in the summer. It was fine. But it was clunky. Facebook kind of felt like black work to campus.
Yes, yes.
So that would just be one engine.
Thank you so much.
Yes, I think that's
more than
45%
of the time.
I'm
going to
move that time clock so you can come through here and actually get out of here.
Betsy, a set up a monthly buffet.
Yeah, you're welcome. I, were you